فمن اتقى وأصلح فلا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Based on the code, buy one, get one free, I'm going to give you salam one more time. Because I gave the first salam, I didn't get the reply, except from few. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi la yu'badu haqqan illa Allah, wa ma bikum min ni'matin fa min Allah. لا مانع لما أعطى ولا معطي لما منع ألا له الحكم تبارك الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له أخذ موسى من أمه طفلا ورعاه وساقه إلى حجر عدوه فرباه وجاز عليه بالنعم وأعطاه خرج موسى يطلب نارا فشرفه الله وناداه إنني أنا الله لا إله إلا أنا فاعبدني وأقم الصلاة حمدا لمن نبيه قد بعث فدوخت بعوثه من قد عثى ثم الصلاة والسلام ما حكت حمائم حمائما إذا بكت وهزت الغصون أنفاس الصبا فهيج صبابة لمن صبا وطاف بالبيت منيب واعتكف على أجل مرسل وآله وصحبه وتابعي من واله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون واتقوا يوما ترجعون فيه إلى الله ثم أما بعد to our respected brothers in faith and our sisters in Islam We are delighted to come back again in this blessed place, Masjid al-Ribat, seeing the brothers and the sisters, Lisa Murabitin. My memory only goes back to 2010, like 8 years back when we came. And we are here tonight. We have only 30 minutes to talk. And if we go extra, we will not exceed 40, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. And afterwards, I will ask your permission to leave right away. Because I have a flight to catch. And it's American Airlines. So if I miss it, We don't have Ridwell Airline to take me back to Philly. So I have to make sure we be on time so that they can take us back home on time. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. So when we start this lecture, I'm shooting straight. So I hope and pray. Sorry, I saw somebody smiling. When I stop, I'm leaving right away. Maybe shooting straight, that's some Philly lingo. I apologize for using that one. Our topic tonight, sorry the young boys, I don't have VIP seat for you tonight because, you know, the baby boomers took it over. As we said yesterday, you know, the baby boomers and the X generation, they just picked up your seat. So I apologize tonight. We don't have enough time to set up for you to get your own seat. But I can see يعقوب قل عنه رويس وروحهم وإسحاق مع إدريس عن خلف تلا Welcome. We miss you last night. I asked about you. They said because you were sick. How are you feeling today? Much better? Alhamdulillah. Allah keep you strong. Ameen. Tonight's talk is about, based on what y'all gave me, is the 10 recitations of Quran. I hope that's what y'all gave. Or something else. That's the topic? Okay. If y'all want, we can switch, you know, change gear anytime y'all want. So since that's what y'all gave, we will talk about that specific topic, the 10 recitations. Now, when it comes to Quran, when it comes to the recitations of Quran, whatever does not sound familiar, some people deny, they reject. And just like we all agree, if you say, I only believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have nothing to do with Muhammad Rasulullah. I only believe in the first segment of Shahada, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Since he's my creator, I only submit to him. But the other part of the Shahada, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, I get nothing to do with it. And I don't want to testify to that part. Will you be considered as a Muslim? It's agreed upon. Likewise, a Quran or Qira'ah that came from Prophet Sallallahu out of the 10, well agreed upon. If you denied one simply because it's not known to you or does not sound well, just like the way Shahada took you part out of the pale of the deen, denying one Shahada or denying one Qira'ah is absolutely just like that. It takes you out of the pale of the deen. Because all came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kullum min indi rabbina. All together, conclusively, came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not only even a qira'ah. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, the one known as the jurist of the companions, he said, denying a letter from Qur'an or denying a letter of Qur'an is absolute kufr. It takes a person out of the pale of the deen. Why? Because all the huruf and all the kalimat came from who? Allah. So denying a portion is like denying all together. أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Will you then believe in a portion of the scripture and deny the other portion because it does not sink, you know, well with you? So Quran all together, when we say Quran, we do not mean what you know. We do not mean the Qira'ah that you are familiar with. It does not mean the Quran or Qira'ah that your imam recites. It does not mean the Qira'ah that you may hear when we recite. It means whatsoever complete the three conditions that imams put together, based on what the Sahaba narrated from Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and based on what the companions heard from him directly, Sallallahu Alaihi Wa Ala Alihi Wa Sahbihi Wasallam. Because this Quran or this ilm of Qira'at that we all have come to know had the root from Bukhari, Muslim, Muwatta of Imam Malik and the books of Masanid. In Muwatta of Imam Malik, a man came and he prayed. Umar heard him reciting Surah Al-Furqan, but he recited it, however, differently. So Umar asked him, you just recited a portion of Surah Al-Furqan, and the same surah that you recited, I heard it from Prophet ﷺ, and I have memorized it, but you read it differently from what I heard it from Prophet ﷺ. So only two options. Either you prove what you read to me, or I take you to Prophet ﷺ. If not, you're going to get some sadaqah on your back. Umar doesn't play. If you just fabricated some, you're just going to get some whipping. That's the sadaqah you're talking about. Because you cannot just alter or change a portion of the scripture just because you feel like this is how I want to do it. Then that companion said, no. I heard it from Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Then Umar said, and I heard the same thing also from Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Both of them agreed upon. They rapidly dashed to Nabiyyil Ummati alayhi rahmatu rabbil izzah. And when they went, both sat before Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because when he was coming, Umar, you know, he just like holding him with his own kind of like choking him so that he does not escape. So when he get to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Prophet said, Arsiluhu, you know, just released him. So he released him. He said, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he recited from Quran what you taught me, but he recited it differently. We don't want Quran to be change or alter those, somebody to come up with something into that book. So Prophet asked him to recite, he recited. He then asked Umar to recite, Umar recited. Then Prophet ﷺ said, the way he recited, هَكَذَا أُنزِلْ. And the way you recited also, Umar, هَكَذَا أُنزِلْ. إِنَّ الْقُرْآنَ أُنزِلَ عَلَىٰ سَبْعَةِ أَحْرُفٍ. Quran was revealed based on 7 different ahruf, meaning methods. With whichever you are familiar with that you've learned from someone who is qualified to teach, and you get it from him the way he was taught from me, because I also get mine from Jibreel, and Jibreel got it from Almighty Rabbil Izzah. That's the same Quran from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, revealed based on how many methods? 7. And the 7 methods, does that mean the 7 well-known qira'ah that Imam al-Shatibi mentioned in his own Shatibiyah? It does not mean that. Some scholars said the 7 methods go all the way to even 80 different ways. But what is agreed upon today among the people of ilm al-qira'at is that 10 at least is well documented from our Salafil Ummah, and it's all accepted by them. So if you want to recite Quran today, it has to be from the well-known 10. And the 10, each has at least 2 students. We have how many Qura? 10. Each at least had 2 students that narrated the Qura'ah from him and sat for years and years to teach. And the Quran or the Qira'ah was attached to him. But the Quran or Qira'ah being attached to that person or that Tabi'i or Tabi'i Tabi'i or the one who came after does not mean he is the one who just sat down because he feel good and he started coming up with different methods and then he decided. The people said, man, mashallah, that's a good way to recite, and they accepted. It that's not how it came. Quran, first and foremost, is from Allah. Kalamullahi subhanahu wa ta'ala ghayru makhluqin. It's not created, it's spoken, and Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala said it just like the way Jibreel received it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ زَعَمَ أَنَّهُ كَلَامُ الْبَشَرِ وَمَنْ زَعَمَ أَنَّهُ كَلَامُ الْبَشَرِ فَقَدْ كَفَرُ وَقَدْ أَوْعَدَهُ اللَّهُ بِسَقَرُ حَيْثُ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى سَأُصْلِيهِ سَقَرُ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا سَقَرُ لَا تُبْقِي وَلَا تَذَرُ لَوَّاحَةٌ لِلْبَشَرِ. This is the statement of Imam Abu Ja'far al-Warraq al-Tahawi in his Aqidah of Tahawiyah that ulama'ul millah accepted as the Aqidah of Salaf al-Ummah, or one of the books of Aqaid that Ummah accepted from this Imam that is genuine book of Aqidah. So what Imam al-Tahawi said is that whosoever, you know, listens to part of Quran or recites part of it and claims that that portion of Quran is kalam of Bashar, meaning kalam of a created object or kalam of somebody, human being, that person is absolutely out of the deen, because this is not what Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated. What did Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Almighty said that this statement is not qawlul bashar, because that's the claim of the kuffar. They said Quran, it's from Muhammad. وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّهُمْ يَقُولُونَ إِنَّمَا يُعَلِّمُهُ بَشَرُ لِسَانُ الَّذِي يُلْحِدُونَ إِلَيْهِ أَعْجَمِي وَهَذَا لِسَانٌ عَرَبِيٌ إِهِ Mubin. They said what Muhammad is reciting is from somebody whom he had learned from. So Muhammad did not get this from Allah, did not get it from Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah denied that. So in Surah Al-Muddathir, Almighty says, whosoever claims that is the statement of Bashar, meaning human being, is what? فَقَدْ كَفَرْ. He's out of the pale of the what? The deen, because he's denying what Almighty Allah said. If you deny what Almighty Allah said, are you part of his faith or the deen that he gave? How can you deny something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said and you're still claiming to be following his own religion? It does not add up and does not make sense. So this is how Quran came from Allah, first and foremost. So all the qira'at is not somebody who just recited, because in different hadith, a man came to Prophet ﷺ and he recited Quran, but the way Prophet ﷺ recited it, it wasn't known to him. And some of the pronunciation wasn't as easy as the man thought. So he said, Prophet ﷺ, this Quran the way you recited is not familiar to us based on our tongue. Then Prophet ﷺ asked for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and yukhaffifu ala al-ummah, to make it easy upon the ummah. That's when Jibreel came with what? Another method. Then he asked, Jibreel came with another. He asked, Jibreel came with another. Until we get all together, how many methods? Seven. So the 10 qira'at is part of the seven methods. It does not mean each method is qira'ah. It doesn't mean that. When we say methods, different ways of reciting something, different ways of pronunciation. And the beginning of the book of Imam Ibn al-Jazr in his book, Tayyibat al-Nashr, he made a mention of this. That when we say, he said, tanaza' an-nas, scholars, they've, you know, these opinions have divided as to what is the meaning of ahruf. So he said the best interpretation of ahruf is that this is methods of reading Quran. So the seven methods, the 10 recitations are part of the seven methods. So when a person recites, his or her recitation must be in compliance with the following three conditions. First, it has to be based on what Arabiya, meaning the language of Arabic. Arabic language with its own Nahw came with. It has to be based on the Arabic language and the Nahw. You cannot recite Quran and go against the Qawa'id of Nahw for it to be considered as what? As Quran. So we have three conditions. For anything to be considered as Quran, we have three conditions. The first is it must be based on what? Arabic language with its own Nahw. And by the way, Arabic language and Nahw are two separate things. Usually people or students think that Nahw and Arabi are the same. They're not the same. We have Arabi and we have Nahw itself. So both, they move together. If you're strong in this and you're not strong in the other one, you're still going to mess up. So you have to be strong in both. And Nahw basically deals with the last letter of each word. But the Arabic is general. So it has to be in compliance with Arabic language with its own what? Nahw. Not to go against the kalam of Arabs before. Because Quran was revealed based on what? Inna anzalnahu Qur'anan Arabiyya. And also in Zukhruf, inna ja'alnahu Qur'anan Arabiyya. Nazzala bihi ar-ruh al-amina ala qalbika litakuna min al-munzirin bilisanin arabiyyin mubin. So this is pure Arabic, not Gwala Gwala Arabic. The pure one. Classic. The way that they themselves, when they heard it, they couldn't deny. Why? Because they knew that no one can come up with something like this. So it has to be based on one, Arabic, not against. كلامنا لفظ مفيد كاستقم واسم وفعل ثم حرف الكلم. As Imam Ibn Malik said, it has to be based on their kalam. أما الكلام اصطلاحا فهو عندهم مركب فيه إسناد كقام علي. It has to be based on their own kalam, like Abu Abdullah al-Shibrawi mentioned. Not against. That's the first rukun of qira'ah or Quran. The second rukun, it has to be based on the script or the rasm of Uthmani. The way Sahaba wrote Quran is different from the way you and I write Arabic today. The Arabic of Quran is different from Arabic today. And we have a special or specific science that deals with this. Imam Abu Amr al-Dani, who died 444 after the Hijrah, he wrote a book about the science of al-Rasm, the way they wrote Quran. Imam al-Shatibi rahimahullah, barakallahu fiqh. Imam al-Shatibi rahimahullah, he summarized the book and he named it Aqilatu Atrab al-Qasaid fi ilm al-Rasm. عقيدة أتراب القصائد في أسنى المقاصد في علم الرسم. He put it in the poetic verses. 299 lines. In it, he will mention something. He said, وَقَالَ مَالِكُنِ الْقُرْآنُ يُكْتَبُ بِالْكِتَابِ الْأَوَّلِ لَا مُسْتَحْدَثًا سُطِرًا. Imam Malik was asked, can we write Arabic based on our, you know, way of writing today? He said, no, it has to remain based on the way Sahaba wrote it. When did they come together to put it together and write it? Basically, Quran was written when Wahy was coming, because Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had some group of people, or his companions are known, some of them are Kutabul Wahy, those who used to write down Wahy for him. As he's reciting, they used to what? Write it down. Because he himself, no reading, no writing. So the Sahaba used to what? And this by itself is a proof that this is not from him. It's from somebody. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's Quran. And in this, if I ask you to write the word al-layl, the word al-layl in Arabic is alif, lam, lam, yay, al-lam. In Quran is alif, lam, yay, lam. That's it. If you write al-layl, alif, lam, lam, yay, lam, and you say it's Quran, that's not Quran. That's our Arabic today. If I ask you to write la'adbahanna wa jaza'u al-zalimina la'adbahanna, I guarantee you, even those of us that are purely 100% professors in Arabic, we cannot write the word la'adbahanna the way it was written in Quran. The word jaza'u al-zalimin the way it was written in Quran. Barakallahu fiqh. Unless the science of rasm is what? It's what? It's learned. If you don't learn it, because it's a science. If you don't learn something, obviously you will not know it. So this is a specific, you know, science that other than qira'at is also there. عِلْقٌ عَلَائِقُهُ أَوْلَى الْعَلَائِقِ إِذْ خَيْرُ الْقُرُونِ أَقَامُوا أَصْلَهُ وَزَرًا. That this, the best Qurun, they put it together in their own what? Rasm. They ask you to write shay in Arabic, it's not the same shay in Quran. Completely different. And when you read, you're going to see all this. And this science in Al-Hirz Institute, Ilm al-Rasm, we teach this science. And the same thing, Ilm al-Qira'at, in Al-Hirz Institute, we teach also all the 10. So basically, ilm al-rasm deals with the way Sahaba what? Put it together when they heard it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If they give you Quran to read or to recite, you may be the Sibawai of 21st century, but if someone did not sit you down to recite for you to repeat, 95% you're going to read it wrong. And it doesn't matter. You can be an Arab. If you don't learn it, you're still going to read it wrong, because this is scriptural language. It doesn't matter that, you know, you were native in the language, so you can read it. This is Quran. Nobody had spoke Arabic better than Prophet Muhammad. No one. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is there any? Is there any who spoke Arabic better than Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Do you have? Only few people saying, I don't know, maybe in San Diego, you have some super Arabs. I don't know. Do you have any? No one. Even Sahaba said, they were amazed and aghast when he speaks, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But guess what? When Jibreel came to him, did he just tell him, you know, this is the Quran, just read it, or Jibreel recited and he repeated after Jibreel? And Jibreel used to stop him from time to time, stop here, don't stop here, move here, recite it this way. And we have in Quran even waqafat to Jibreel, places where Jibreel asked Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to stop when he was reciting, and he's the best in Arabic, but yet he's listening to Jibreel, and he's what? Responding. And even sometimes he will go faster than Jibreel will tell him, you know, just take it easy, until Allah revealed, لَا تُحَرِّكْ بِهِ لِسَانَكَ لِتَعْجَلَ بِهِ إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا جَمْعَهُ وَقُرْآنَهُ فَإِذَا قَرَأْنَاهُ فَاتَّبِعْ قُرْآنَهُ ثُمَّ إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا Bayana. When he recites, Jibreel recites, he used to recite quick and faster so he can capture, until Almighty said to him, no, just take it easy. Read it, you know, with two other when he recites. ولا تعجل بالقرآن من قبل أن نقضي إليك وحيه أو من قبل أن يقضى إليك وحيه. Do not chase or hasten with the recitation of Quran before the wahy is over. Wait. When he recites, you recite. When he goes some, you know, certain way, follow the same method, because this is how Quran is supposed to be what? Recited. And all of these, I mention it in my book, Arabic Quran effortlessly memorized. How Jibreel recited and how Prophet ﷺ responded to him as he was what? Reciting. So this is Quran. You have to have someone to recite it to you, because the best of the best, if you ask the best who is the best will tell you the best altogether to the best is Muhammadun sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dhirwatu dhura sayyidu waladi adama ajma'in. Yet he waited for someone to recite for him to what? Repeat. So this is how Quran was. So the based on the ilm al-rasm, how they put it together, and in the battle of Irminiya, when companions came together in this battle, some of them from Iraq, some of them came from, you know, south, from Mecca, some from Medina, some came from, you know, Bahrain. When they came together, what happened is that they started reciting Quran. And the people that learned based on the Quran qira'ah of Kufa, they decided differently from the Quran or Qira'ah of the people in Mecca. So they started arguing. They said, no, our Quran is the best. And others said, no, 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 ours is the best. Just like today, in Muslims, in our societies, hey, if you're not Hanafi, man, you know, just don't pray even here, because the Hanafi madhab is what we pray based on. Hey, we Shafi'iyya, we Malikiyya, we even this. That just this idea is stepped up among the companions in the battle of Irminiya as who has the best Quran. That's when Hudhayfa heard and saw the discrepancies that took place in this battle. Rapidly he dashed to Uthman. Uthman was the Khalifa at that time. وَكَانَ فِي بَعْضِ مَغْزَاهُمْ مُشَاهِدَهُمْ حُذَيْفَةُ فَرَأَى مِنْ خُلْفِهِمْ عِبَرًا فَجَاءَ عُثْمَانُ مَذْعُورًا فَقَالَ لَهُ فَجَاءَ عُثْمَانَ مَذْعُورًا فَقَالَ لَهُ أَخَافُ أَنْ يَخْلِطُوا فَأَدْرِكُوا الْبَشَرَ فَاسْتَحْضَرَ الصُّحُفَ الَّتِي جُمِعَتْ وَخَصَّ زَيْدًا وَمِنْ قُرَيْشِهِ نَفَرًا عَلَى لِسَانِ قُرَيْشٍ فَاكْتُبُوهُ كَمَا عَلَى الرسول به إنزاله انتشر. When he was in the battle of Irminiya, companions are now dividing, and some saying ours is the best Quran and ours is the best Qira'at. Hudhayfa said, no, I have to reach out to the Amir and reach out to the Khalifa. That's when he went to Amir al-Mu'mineen Uthman. He said, you have to bring all of them and ask them to come based on one single mus'af by taking from what Abu Bakr wrote at his own time. The mus'af that they put together during the Uthman time, they call it what? They call that mus'af al-umm when Uthman put it together. So he said, bring all what we wrote before. So they brought all what the Sahaba wrote from the time of Sahaba, from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everything came together, and then he asked Zayd, who was young, he wasn't old. He asked Zayd, since Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not pass away until he was what? Pleased with you, and you were among those who documented. That means you're trustworthy. Come and take from the one that Abu Bakr had and copy it. Make sure you put it in one single what? Mus'haf. So he brought everything, all the 10 qira'at that we have, all together in one big volume. That's what happened. All together in one big volume. So that all Muslims will what? Will agree upon one thing. So that we do not divide. Because division is what killed the Muslim ummah today. That's what keep us, you know, all the time we can't even function. We can't move forward because of the division. So Uthman killed the division from its own cradle. And he brought all of them together, and Ubay ibn Ka'ab, along with some people from Quraysh, since Quran was revealed based on Quraysh dialect and their own language, he said to him, عَلَى لِسَانِ قُرَيْشٍ فَاكْتُبُوهُ كَمَا عَلَى الرَّسُولِ بِهِ إِنْزَالُهُ انْتَشَرَ. Based on the lisan of Quraysh, put it together and write it down, because this is what came from our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he wrote everything in one mus'haf, one big volume, Uthman started to tell them What I want you to do right now is that from this this Quran, this Mus'haf became al-umm, meaning the mother. The what? The mother. Because this book was with Uthman. So when Uthman passed away, our mother, Hafsa, she kept the mother, the book. And this to our sisters, if our sisters hear that this Mus'haf and this deen, you were not behind. Can you imagine that even a time had passed that, like, let's say female, she get the mother with her. Umm al-mu'minina Hafsata radiyallahu anha wa ardaha. So sisters, this Quran is yours because our mother, she got it before even Uthman what? Called for it. So Uthman asked them, now I want you to take this riwayah and take it from the from the mother and put it in what? In different mus'haf. And take from this another what? Riwayah, put it in different mus'haf. So from that he took all the what? All the 20. Different methods, because if you remember and recall, we said we had 10, and each at least had what? 2 students. So if we have 10 qira'at, and what we do is that when we recite based on riwayah, we recite based on narration, not the qira'at itself. So that means we have 20 riwayah. Each qari has 2 rawi. Each qari has how many rawi? 2 transmitters. So he will take this transmission or this riwayah and put it in this mus'haf. This riwayah in this mus'haf. This riwayah in this mus'haf. This riwayah until he finished from the all the 10 that we have today and the 20 narrations that we have today. When he finished and sealed, Imam al-Shatibi mentioned in Aqilat Atrab al-Qasaid, وَسَارَ فِي نُسَخٍ مِّنْهَا مَعَ الْمَدَنِي Kufin wa Shamin wa Basrin Tamla ul Basara. He asked them to travel with what he now took from the mother to these 3 different places. Take one to Mecca, take one to Medina, take one to Sham, take one to Kufa, and take the what? The other one to Bahrain. That's the meaning of Wasara Nusakhim Minha Ma'al Madani. Kufin wa Shamin wa Basrin Tamla ul Basara. And this is how the Quran traveled around. And now people from the mother, they have that which is agreed upon. That's how Uthman did it. So now from this, we have what? We have the well-known 10 Qurra. And the 10 Qurra, if you want to know them, or they ask you who were they, or what they did not fabricate it from themselves. Because when Prophet ﷺ started reciting from Sahaba, we have well-known Qurra, well-known reciters of Qur'an among Sahaba. Imam Shamsuddin al-Dhahabi, in his book, Ma'rifat al-Qurra al-Kibar, he mentioned the tabaqat. He put them in different what? In different levels. The highest is that of Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, because they heard it from Prophet ﷺ directly. And the tabaqat of Sahaba, on the top of the list, is Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu anhu, the one who used to write Quran with his own hand when Prophet ﷺ was alive. And then you have the second companion, Ubay ibn Ka'b, the one whom Almighty sent Jibreel for Prophet ﷺ to recite Surah al-Bayyinah or al-Qayyimatum, and he started crying when Jibreel came down with his name. And then we have Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, and then we have Ali radiyallahu anhu, and then we have Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiyallahu anhu, and then and from this heavyweight, we have the welterweight of Sahaba, because Sahaba, they are not all the same level. We have Kibar al-Sahaba, and we have those under them, and then we have Sigar al-Sahaba. Not all of them the same level. Just like al-Rusul tilka al-Rusul faddalna ba'dahum ala ba'd, likewise the Sahaba. بعضهم فضلوا على بعض. So some of them are above others. So when it comes to Quran, the highest level, the names that you heard. And from them, we have Sahaba that also learned from them because they are the youngest among Sahaba. أمثال عبد الله بن عباس رضي الله عنه وأرضاه زر بن حبيش and those مغيرة, all of them narrated from the top. companions. So from them, the Tabi'een also what took from. And those who came after them, like Abdurrahman, Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, he took from Ali, radiallahu anhu wa arda. And from Imam Ali, he narrated his own Quran. So Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, he is the teacher of Imam, or from him, Imam Asim, that we all know today, learn. And from Imam Asim, we have Hafs, the well-known Quran that if you pick right now, the one that you will have is Hafs and Asim. So see the chain from Hafs ibn Sulaiman to his teacher Asim, Abu ibn Bahdala al-Najudi, from his teacher Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, from Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami's teacher, who was that? Ali ibn Abi Talib. From Ali ibn Abi Talib's teacher, who was that? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his teacher, the one who taught him how to recite, who was that? Jibril al-Amin. And Jibril al-Amin, where did he get his Quran from? From Rabbul Izzati Jalla Jalalu. And Quran came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So think not when we say Hafs Qira'a or riwaya, it means like there's no connection. No, there is connection. And from that, we have Quran available today. So if you want to know the 10, the following are the 10. If you want to know them, don't ask Google, because Google cannot. Sorry, Sheikh. Apologize. Don't ask Google, because Google cannot put it the way the Sahaba put it together. Don't ask Bing. Don't ask Yahoo.com. And don't ask Ask.com. And don't ask Wikipedia or Wikipedia. Go straight from them, because they have it documented from our Salaf al-Ummah, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. And those Qurra, they from Medina, Mecca, Sham, and Kufa or Iraqayn together. That's where they came from. So now take them in this order. The first is Abu Ruwaym. Abu Ruwaym Nafi' al-Madani. Number two. The second, Qari, is Abdullah ibn Kathir al-Makki. So we have Nafi' al-Madani. We have Abdullah ibn Kathir al-Makki. We have Abu Amr al-Sham, Abu Amr. Abu Amr, the teacher of the two students that you will hear their names, bi-idhnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala, known as Abu Amr al-Basri. And then the fourth is Ibn Amir al-Shami. Fifth is Asim al-Najudi. Sixth is Imam Hamza ibn Habib al-Zayyat al-Kufi. Seventh is Ali al-Kisai al-Kufi. Eighth, Abu Ja'far Yazid ibn al-Qa'qa' al-Madani. Eighth or ninth, that's Imam Ya'qub al-Hadrami. And tenth is Imam Khalafun al-Baghdadi. How many? 10 altogether, from Nafi' all the way to Khalaf al-Baghdadi, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. And each one of them had at least how many students? Two. The first Imam is Imam Nafi'. His two students is Imam Uthman and Qalun. Uthman is the one who is known as Warsh, and his second student is Qalun. The second Imam, who was he? Ibn Kathir. He had Bazzi and Qumbul. The third Imam, who was he? Abu Amr al-Basri. He had Susi and Imam al-Duri. The fourth Imam, who was he? Ibn Amir al-Shami. He had Imam ibn Hisham, and he has Ibn Dhakwan. The fifth Imam, who was he? Asim al-Najudi. His student, Shu'bah, and Imam Hafs. Sixth Imam, who was he? Hamza. He had two students. First is Khalaf and Khalad. But these two did not meet Imam Hamza. Rather, what they did, they took from the student of Hamza, radiallahu anil jami'. But the student that took directly from Hamza is known as Sulaym. So from Sulaym, the two students took the qira'ah of Hamza, but they became more popular than their own teacher. And then the seventh Imam, who was he? See, if we share in Banja Malis with you, y'all memorize it quickly. Kisa'i. Kisa'i had also two. He has Abu al-Harith and Imam al-Duri wa fi al-Dhikri qad khala. And then the eighth Imam, who was he? Abu Ja'far. He had two. He had Ibn Wardan and he had Ibn Jammaz. The eighth Imam, who was he? And the ninth Imam, who was he? Huh? Ya'qub al-Hadrami. He had two. He had Rawh and Ruwais. The last Imam, who was he? Khalaf al-Baghdadi. He had what? Two. He had Ishaq and Idris. وَيَعْقُوبُ قُلْ عَنْهُ رُوَيْسٌ وَرَوْحُكُمْ وَإِسْحَاقُ مَعْ إِدْرِيسَ عَنْ خَلَفٍ تَلَى. You want to get them and memorize them? Imam al-Shati put them in what? In the poetic lines. And Imam Ibn al-Jazari also did the same. From the time he mentioned Imam Nafi', فَأَمَّا الْكَرِيمُ السِّرِّ فِي الطِّيبِ نَافِعٌ فَذَاكَ الَّذِي اخْتَارَ الْمَدِينَةَ مَنْزِلًا. And then he mentioned the second imam, وَمَكَّةُ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ فِيهَا مُقَامُهُ هُوَ ابْنُ كَثِيرٍ كَاثِرُ الْقَوْمِ مُعْتَلَى. Then he mentioned the third imam, وَأَمَّا الْإِمَامُ الْمَازِنِيُّ صَرِيحُهُمْ أَبُو عَمْرٍ الْبَصْرِي فَوَالِدُهُ الْعَلَى. Then he mentioned the fourth imam, Imam ibn Amir, وَأَمَّا دِمَشْقُ الشَّامِ دَارُ ابْنِ عَامِرٍ فَتِلْكَ بِعَبْدِ اللَّهِ طَابَتْ إِيهِ طَابَتْ مُحَلَّلًا. Then he mentioned the three from Kufa. وَبِالْكُوفَةِ الْغَرَّاءِ مِنْهُمْ ثَلَاثَةٌ أَذَاعُوا فَقَرًا فُلَى فَأَمَّا أَبُو بَكْرٍ وَعَاصِمٌ اسْمُهُ فَشُعْبَةُ رَاوِيهِ الْمُبَرِّزُ أَفْضَلَ وَذَاكَ ابْنُ عَيَّاشٍ أَبُو بَكْرٍ الرِّضَى وَحَفْصٌ وَبِالْإِتْقَانِ كَانَ مُفَضَّلًا وَحَمْزَةُ مَا أَزْكَاهُ مِنْ مُتَوَرِّعٍ إِمَامًا صَبُورًا لِلْقُرْآنِ مُرَتِّلًا روى أحمد روى خلف عنه وخلاد الذي رواه سليم متقنا وإيه ومحصلا وأما علي فالكسائي نعته لما كان في الإحرام فيه تسربلا. These are the seven that Imam al-Shatibi mentioned in his own book known as حرز الأماني ووجه التهاني رضي الله عن الجميع. And then Imam ibn al-Jazari in his Ad-Durra mentioned the remaining three from Abu Ja'far to the last. He said about Abu Ja'far, Abu Ja'far عنه ابن وردان ناقل كذاك ابن جماز سليمان ذو العلا ويعقوب قل عنه رويس وروحهم وإسحاق مع إدريس عن خلف تلا. You get this locked in, that's it, you get all the 10. How can you get this locked in if you don't eat too much and you don't sleep too much and you stay away from extra chicken wings? Okay. So inshallah tabarak wa ta'ala, we wanted to keep on pushing, but my time is up. And you know, American Airlines waiting. And I'm sorry, brothers and sisters, I didn't even start the topic. All what you heard is just sneak preview. I did not even start the lecture yet. So this is just, you see me sweating? So this is to get in the ring. I started sweating just to get in the ring of this vast, what do you call it, science. But inshallah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of you.
Amen.
And to keep all of you strong. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward you and bless all of you. Barakallahu feek. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep all of you strong. But before we leave, what we will say that a person who is blessed to have Quran is the best among the ummah, only and only if he or she applies what he or she knows. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. But sometimes a person could also be the best without knowing or being knowledgeable. So to the brothers who are here and the sisters who are here, I don't think the only way for me to be super and the best Muslim is for me to be knowledgeable. Knowledge, nothing like knowledge. Just like Imam mentioned, إمام القرواني الحمد لله حمدا ليس منحصرا على أياديه ما يخفى وما ظهر ثم الصلاة وتسليم المهيمن ما حب الصبا فأدر العارض المطر على الذي شاد بنيان الهدى فسما وساد كل الورى فخرا وما افتخر نبينا أحمد الهادي وعترتي وصحبي كل من آوى ومن نصر وبعد فالعلم لم يظفر به أحد إلا سما وبأسباب العلا ظفرا لا سيما أصل علم الدين إن به سعادة العبد والمنجى إذا حشرا. This is in the section of fiqh and aqidah. It's nothing to do with what we talked about. But the point I wanted to get from him is his statement that ilm, knowledge, nobody will be blessed with it except he or she will be what? Excelled and raised above the rest of the people. Especially if that knowledge deals with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed and what his messenger left as a legacy. So that's nothing like ilm. But sometimes you can also reach a highest level without you having the ilm. But it's only commitment and following the salaf al-ummah in everything according to your ability. Have you heard of this man, Uwais ibn Amir in al-Qarani? Uwais ibn Amir, Prophet ﷺ in Sahih Muslim, in the manaqib of Uwais, Imam Muslim al-Naysaburi mentioned the hadith, the fadl and manqaba of Uwais. Prophet ﷺ said, خَيْرُ التَّابِعِينَ رَجُلٌ مِّن مُرَادٍ ثُمَّ مِّن قَرَنٍ لَهُ أُمٌّ هُوَ بِهَا بَرٌ لَوْ أَقْسَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ لَأَبَرَّ. The best tabi'in, the best out of all the tabi'in is a man known as Uwais from the tribe of Murad and Qaran. He had his mother to whom he was dutiful and obedient. Were he to take an oath, Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala will fulfill it for him out of his piety. And Prophet said he is the best out of among the tabi'in. Is it through knowledge? Huh? How many statements or quotation you get from Uwais? How many? I ask you, you don't even have one. If I ask, you don't even have one. But guess what? Prophet said he's what? The best. You know how I became the best? Commitment to the deen. And following the code. And attaching himself to the predecessors. And he had a mother. And he was obedient to her. The young boys here, y'all think because, you know, you get some little hair on your chest and now you and your father, you're the same. And because you're 18, you and your mother, when she says sit, you say I'm standing. When she say come, you say I'm going. And because you get your wife and you put your mother in the back seat and you and your wife chilling out, act, you're going to be in trouble if you don't switch. Your mother and your father, it doesn't matter how knowledgeable you are. Or how wealthy you are, you still their sons. You still their daughters. Or you still their own daughter. So you can never, can you be older than your father? Can you be older than your mother? So just get it, don't get it twisted. Because maybe in an environment, if you're 18, like you, super. Thinking like you, Superman, you can just jump from building to another. Keep on jumping, you're going to fall one day when there's no sunny camera or Hitachi on you. See, so Uwais was dutiful to his mother. And do you know what he used to do? Every day when he wakes up, the only food that he had in his house, he would eat half and take the half and serve to the people outside in the street. Serve people outside in the street. And then he, the only clothes that he had, if he had extra, like let's say something like this here on the top, he will remove this one and then just go give it in charity. And he will say to Allah, oh Allah, the only thing in my stomach is the food that I had. The rest is given in charity. And the only clothes that I have is what you see on me. And the rest is given in charity. If I die out of hunger or lack of clothes, please, oh Allah, forgive me and don't hold me accountable because I have to share what I have. I made always the best, huh? Through what? Service. Helping out. So if you're not knowledgeable, that does not mean that you're outdated and you cannot be the vanguard or up front for the deen. It's commitment. Khalid ibn Walid, give me one hadith from Khalid. Brothers, give me one hadith from Khalid ibn Walid. Hello? You don't have? Can we be like Khalid? Can we be today? Can you have someone like Khalid ibn Walid? So he got it, but not through what? Ilm. Though ilm, nothing like it. So don't get it twisted. But this is just a message that you could do enough, even if you don't have enough ilm. Al-Ayyubi Salahuddin alayhi rahmatu rabbil alameen. How many statements, how many ahadith? How many Quran or how much of Quran did he, how much of Quran did he computerize or kept in his heart? But commitment. When someone disrespected Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Khalid Ibn Ayyubi, Salahuddin, he was sick. A man, Arna, he said when he captured Muslims and he took their wealth and took their, you know, merchandise, he said, Aina Muhammadukum Yansurukum, where is your Muhammad to help you out? Salahuddin was on a sick bed. He said, oh Allah, please don't take my soul until I teach this man a lesson. Not long ago, Salahuddin gained his strength. He met the same guy. in the spot, the Battle of Hittin. So when he met him, he said, "You the one who said, 'Aina Muhammadukum yansurukum,' where is your Muhammad Muslims to help you out? Muslims, where is your Muhammad? I need him here today to help you out. The time that you said it, I was in the house sick, and I asked Almighty to reserve my house so I could meet you. So welcome. I'm going to give you the lesson that you're missing. So let's get in the battlefield to see who is antelope and who is the cheetah." He gave him the lesson that Nile crocodile gives to what? The wildebeest. Commitment. We in America, Allah blessed us, and Allah had given us the faith. We're not in the battlefield. We're not fighting anyone. But where the service that we're giving to American people and the people in our own selves, in our own communities? Where? Muslims, we arguing who is on the top of, you know, who is on, I don't know, maybe I don't want to bring, you know, some Philadelphia stuff here. Let me just leave it where it is. Muslims just on some different things, huh? Arguing. It's all about service. It's all about what you can offer. Anas ibn Nadr, on the battle, the day of, you know, Uhud, he said, "I miss this with Prophet, and I miss the one before it with Prophet, but if Allah will allow me to live longer, I will prove to Allah what Anas ibn Nadr is capable of doing for the deen, to represent the deen." So you in America, brothers and sisters, you are representatives of the deen. Because Salahuddin al-Ayyubi, when he met the man, he said, "Ana na'ibu Muhammadun wa Nasir." I am the representative of Muhammad and his supporter and helper. Muslims, can we speak like that today? Because even our own behavior with one another is jacked up, is messed up. How we deal with one another? How we dealing with one another? A person will see someone in the street, "Hey, Jackie, I miss you. How you doing, Jackie?" When he see Abdullah, he doesn't even look at him. Because they have some beef. Acting just like, you know, 50 Cent and T.I. Like even the world that we're living in today, 50 had forgotten his cent. And, you know, Ice, he forgotten his cube. And Snoop forgot his dog. So we have to make sure we keep it straight, Ikhwan. See, Allah bless us with this. Sorry, brothers, if I'm giving it raw like that today. Apologize. See, but inshallah, whatever it is, maybe our imam, may Allah bless him, he will rectify after I'm gone. Inshallah. Barakallahu fi. Brothers, I have to stop. I really want to go ahead, but I have to be in the airport.